Hello, assalamu alaikum. I'm Saba. Want to thank Jehan and Ramesa in particular because they helped make this happen. Yeah, I've met a couple of people in the Bay Area, but I'm really excited to be at Nest, like Jehan said, all in photos, so it's nice to be here in person. Let's see if the clicker works. Maybe not. Okay. So the presentation is probably going to take about an hour, and I'll try to stop in the middle, take some questions and stuff, because I know it's hard to listen to someone for a whole hour. So I'm hoping by the end of the session, you'll get a sense of what UX design is through an example of a project that I've worked on. This is not a presentation on how to become a designer or learn a particular tool or application. So I'm just going to try and paint a broad stroke picture. Then, while I try to bust two myths, I'll try to go into a few principles so you do take away some tangible things from the talk as well. Or lastly, it's just kind of bringing home what's the value of UX, how do you bring it into your company, and why you should do it. So the session is recorded, so hopefully no need to like take notes and stuff, but any questions, any burning thoughts before we get started? No. How many of you guys here are designers, actually? Okay. How many of you work with designers? Okay. How many of you want to become designers in some form? Okay, take it. So I'm going to assume some working knowledge of design, but if you don't understand something, just like interrupt me. So before I get started, I know that design is a pretty unique field. It's kind of hard to get into sometimes because there aren't a lot of courses or degrees on it so far, and it's starting to mature over the last few years. I've met a lot of people who come to design from different backgrounds, so I thought I'd first just tell you my story, my path to design, and how I got there. There are many different paths. So that's me. I was born and raised in Pakistan. My brother, who should be here but is late in traffic, is the one who's hitting me right now. When I was in high school, I always thought that I'll do physics. There's something about conceptual realization of the world that was really interesting to me. But then when I went to college, so I went to Harvard in 2006, I realized that physics was too academic for me. I wanted something that was a little more practical. So then I ended up in engineering. back to the basics, I guess. And at the same time, I was spending most of my spare time doing photography for the school newspaper, publicity work, and that was all like just hobbies. I never thought I would make anything out of it. And then I started feeling like even engineering wasn't human enough. There wasn't much interaction with people, and I wanted something more like that. So I ended up cross-registering at a class at MIT that was about engineering for developing economies. And that was the first time I kind of understood what the design process was. How do you talk to people and understand their problems and design for that? This is a picture of a summit I went to, International Development Design Summit, or IDDS. Some of you might have heard of the one that happened in Lahore. So this was the one in Ghana that I went to. And this is like the time when I kind of figured out, oh, this is what design is. So I graduated, and I mushkil say I found a job at a startup, and I moved to the Bay Area. That's me and my husband. I worked at a late stage startup called Inflection, and I did front end development slash design for a little while, trying to figure out what it is. And then eventually that got acquired by Ancestry.com, which is like a family history genealogy type of website. And then I full on became a designer and sort of let go of front end stuff. And then I moved to Google about 3 years ago. I've been working as interaction designer there. And I work on our help and feedback systems. So if you're ever using a Google product and you get stuck and you Google, like, how do filters work in Gmail or something, you'll probably land on a website that was designed by me. Or if you get stuck on the Play Store and you want a refund, or you know, you're using AdWords and you get stuck and you need to contact Google. So those flows sort of fall under me. So you'll notice in all of this, one, I've never worked at an agency. And I know a bunch of designers work in agencies, so my talk will be skewed a bit more towards design that's embedded within engineering and business teams. Two, I've never worked in Pakistan as a designer. So I'm not going to pretend like I know what's going to work here necessarily. But there's still some, I want to expose you to what I've learned, and maybe you can take back and adapt it to your market. And we can have that discussion afterwards, like, ye cheez to bilkul kaam nahi karegi Pakistan mein or whatever. Okay. So what is design? So, or UX, user experience design. There are a lot of different definitions out there, and it's not super clear what it is. It's really hard to explain to your relatives and to your friends what it is that you do. So let's try to talk through that a little bit. So one of the problems that happens is when you don't understand what design is, you either, this happened to me when I was new. Yato, you have imposter syndrome. You feel like, you know, I should start coding because no one values me. I don't know what I'm doing. Or you become like, oh, design is the best thing in the world and everyone should love me, and I sprinkle pixie dust on the product and it becomes amazing. So I oscillated between these two states a lot, depending on who I was talking to and whether they understood design or not. And then from the business and engineering standpoint, the business people are like, what is this design? We don't have time for it. We'll just bring it at the end. And then the engineer might be like, who are these people? This artsy-fartsy people, they don't know anything. I'm gonna talk, I'll talk to them at the end when I'm done building everything. So I want to kind of demystify some of that and try to get you to a point where you realize that there are three roles in the product development cycle. And one of them is the business guy, the product management. He or she is looking at the product through the business lens, how to make money out of it. Then there's the engineering person who's looking at it from a technical standpoint and seeing, can we actually build it? And then the UX person comes in and says, will the people actually like it? Will they enjoy it? Is it easy to use? And these three roles have to work together in order to launch a successful product. So none of them can work in isolation, and you all have to start from the beginning and take the product till the end. Otherwise, UX gets brought in the last minute and it's too late. So let's talk a bit about what the UX role is, or what the UX person contributes. I'm not going to go into like the double diamonds, and I don't know if you guys all know the different types of processes that UX process can take. But I like to think of it as two buckets. There's figuring out, are you solving the right problem? So these are things like research, so talking to your users, figuring out what problems they have, what pain points they have. And then the scope of the problem. Like, are you going to solve for the next 6 months, 2 months? How long is, what kind of features are you going to build? Those types of conversations. And then a UX designer might help with different brainstorming sessions, help lead the team to understand what's important. Once you've figured out what the problem is that you're solving, then you move on to solving that problem properly. And then the UX designer has some contributions in that process as well. So you do a bunch of different explorations, and this is a lot of like mocks and stuff that we're probably more used to. There's a section on trade-offs and reviews that I want to emphasize, and I'll talk about it a little bit. And this requires an understanding of, you know, what do your stakeholders want? What do the engineers want? And kind of figuring out which of those explorations are you going to choose and take forward. Then you do a lot of testing, and then finally you create all the specs that the engineers make. I'm just going to move forward. Okay. So to walk through this, I'm going to go through a case study from one of my projects. So we built mobile screen share for Pixel phones. So what this basically means is if you're talking to a support agent and you get stuck, the agent can see your screen and then guide you, okay, go here, go here, go here, and then solve your issue. See? So the goal of the project was to speed resolution. So the time that agents take on the phone to try and solve your problem, let's try to make that faster. And the Pixel team wanted something new, something that they could brand as like, hey, this is special about our new phones. Obviously, the users are the people who are buying the phones for the first time. And then the team was, I was the main designer on it, but we also had a researcher who was helping out with the testing and stuff, and a UX writer who helped out with the language. And there are a bunch of other like engineers, PMs, product people, and it took us about 10 months. Let people sit. Okay. So this is sort of what it looks like. I'll just walk through the final product and then we can kind of go back and see how we got there. So say you're stuck. You go into the support of your phone and you click on phone and you're talking to the agent eventually. And then the agent says, okay, to fix this, it'll be better if I can see your screen. And then he sends you an invite that looks like the screen we just showed earlier. It shows you, okay, this is gonna have like some sensitive information and battery istemal hogi, you know, Wi-Fi data istemal hoga, that kind of stuff. And then you click on share. So hopefully this will work. Yeah, so you click on share and then it starts showing like a loader and then it gives like a green indicator that your screen is being shared. And then you have this button that has your pause and end screen share controls in it. And it's just gonna repeat. I'll just let it show one more time. Okay. And once you're in the process, then the agent can send you ripples, basically, okay, click here, click here, click here, go here, fix this, turn off this setting, that kind of thing. Okay, so how did we get here? So the first step, so let's talk about the solving the right problem. So I couldn't take a photo of what the agents were actually doing, so this is the next best thing I could find. So is this actually a problem? Like, would screen share actually help any of our use cases? So what we did was we went to the call centers and we just sat with the customer support agents and listened to their phone conversations and tried to figure out, oh, in that one, it would have been so much easier. Well, it's quick explain, okay, click here, but he doesn't know what phone, what Android phone he has, and they're all just stumbling around. Okay, so these kinds of use cases will work well with screen share. Okay, let's move forward with the project, and this is how it will work. So my role in that was helping organize these shadow sessions, because the team would have otherwise just started feature development without really understanding what the use case was. After that, I led like a design sprint. So you bring a lot of different people in the same room for a day, business people, engineering people, operations people, agents, and then you try to figure out, okay, what extent of this problem are we gonna solve? Is there a button on the phone that you can click to start screen share? Can you do it when the agent's chatting? Can you do it over email? Can the agent draw circles and write on your screen? Like, how, and our time limit is 10 months. Okay, so roughly speaking, we can do these things. And then we created a bunch of mocks and stuff and said, okay, roughly, this is our problem space. In the corner, you'll see like a couple of icons. That's me trying to say these are the skills or the tools that I'm using. So it's chatting and whiteboards. It'll make more sense as I go on. So Google Docs. So the next thing usually what happens is the business person in our company usually tends to write a document that will specify, okay, by the end of this project, we need to meet these goals and this is our scope. And this is more of a business thing, but I still read through those documents and I comment in them and I say, nahi, aise nahi, aise hona chahiye, or whatever, I'm not committing to this. And I help her sort of craft that document. So it's not just them doing it alone. And it's heavily influenced by the sprint that we had. Next, I go kind of crazy. I'll open up Sketch. So people use Illustrator, Photoshop. Most of our company now uses Sketch. And I'll just do mocks and mocks and mocks and mocks and just figure out, okay, here's the end-to-end user flow. From the time that the person has this problem, they call the agent, and then this is how they resolve their problem. These are all the screens that we need to think about. And then I start highlighting, okay, if we did this, it's probably gonna take longer. If we did this, it's gonna take this long. So it helps the team kind of understand. Then I'm gonna talk about a few trade-offs. So there are three of them that I'll talk about. And I mentioned a little bit why this is important in the beginning. So one of them was, for example, if you send the user the invite, it could start off as a notification. And this is what we had in our sprint. It starts off at a notification, you get a permission screen, and then it shows you all this legal work. It's three steps and it looks quite boring. So what if we could just make it one screen? You can barely see it, but this was one of the early wireframes. Like, oh, maybe make it look a lot more friendly. It's just one click. What would it take to do it? And then it turned out, oh, we need to get special permissions from the Pixel team and this and that. But then I, as the UX person, could say, no, this is important for the user. They're going to get confused otherwise. OK, let's make it happen. So the team has to balance the cost versus the benefit to the user. Another one was, what if we just went with notifications? So you saw that little button that opened up and you could pause and end screen share. So that new button would be a completely new pattern. So none of the Google products per se have that pattern. So to build that, I would have to talk to like our material design team that comes up with a lot of components, and with my own engineering team and say, oh, this is not a component you can use. You have to build something from scratch. Is it worth it? And then we went through all those reviews and said, no, this is worth it because the user is not going to notice a notification and they're going to forget. And then in the end, we did end up doing this. And the last trade-off I'll mention, which kind of goes in reverse, UX didn't win in this one. So I wanted the ripple that the agent sends, it should stay on the screen until the user clicks on that target. So if you say, oh, apps, it should stay on that until the user hits app. But it actually is really, really difficult to implement because you need a lot of signals from the phone. And it exposes the phone to a lot of hacking kind of issues. So in the end, it wasn't safe to do, and we decided we could get pretty far without doing all that engineering work. So it just ripples once, and the agent can click again to send it again. And then after that, I'll actually do the UI sort of work, a lot of explorations of what the visuals should be, make sure it's on brand. This isn't quite in order, just to in the interest of time, but we did two rounds of testing. So at the top, it's one of our usability labs. We bring in users, we sit with them, try to make them feel comfortable. I had a UX researcher help me with this. So the first time I did it, we have this tool called Flow internally. It's basically like InVision and stuff where you click, have hot targets and the user can click through. So I made one of those prototypes, showed it to people, got some feedback, changed the designs. And then once engineering had a prototype, a live coding prototype, we tested again. So like I mentioned, lots of reviews. I think one of the things people forget is that half of the designer's job, I feel, is communication. You need to talk and you need to convince people. And so most of the time, I've done my designs. I actually have to pitch them and tell people that it's worth building. So not only within my team, that's usually easier, but also to all these other teams that have their own roadmaps and own plans that this is worth building. And then making sure it's approved by legal and privacy or all that stuff as well. And then the final thing I'll do is actually spec it out. And I had another designer help me with this part as well. You know, okay, these are the pixels, these are the images, make sure the images are the right size. For the animation, here's the length of the duration of the animation, it fades in, flows out, all that stuff. This comes right at the end, but there's a lot of work that comes in before it. And then the little red thing is I file bugs. So I also have to make sure that what I spec out gets built the right way, and that itself takes a couple of weeks. So the design we built did meet the business constraints, so making sure that it meets different teams' goals. We're showing the right kind of warnings to the user, we're not doing anything illegal, trying to meet our business goals. And then obviously it has to be buildable within the right amount of time, should be secure, and then Android itself has all these limitations around size limits and all of that. So it has to meet both these things. I can't just come up with my own design. And then we launched it. This was in October. There's like one slide in the many slides on the Pixel announcement, but you know, it's fun to see it being mentioned. But even then, it doesn't end there. We have to, even as designers, look at the metrics. You know, did we meet our goals? Did we not meet our goals? And a lot of the time, what I hear from people is, it's like, it's not my job. Your business wale ki hai. Like, no, you have to take ownership of the work. And that only then can you play a strategic role in the product development process. Okay. So any questions about that project?
What's the average time span of the process?
So this took about 10 months. So we usually have things in quarters. We have goals set every 3 months. So we try to usually line up with that. This one was a really hard deadline because the Pixel announcement was there. Then we had to work backwards and say, what can we accomplish by that time? And we'll obviously make improvements and send updates, but yeah.
Okay, for
I think it was about 8 each time. Eight times 2.
So you have conducted at the start and at the end. How many waves?
Two waves. Yeah. So that's a really interesting question because we were launching for Pixel, so, and the Pixel phone wasn't out yet, and it was very hard to actually get hold of Pixel phones, which is also why I have the phone that I have right now. It's the Nexus 6P was the only phone that was close enough to the Pixel, so we tested on that. Now as we look into expanding screen share, we're going to be testing with like Samsung or whatever, or I mean, we don't know which ones we're going to actually end up with. But we'll probably start off with Nexus phones. Those are usually our main. If we're doing things for Google branded sort of stuff, we usually go with Nexus and Pixel. Otherwise, we try to test with OEMs as well.
Is there any onboarding for this? Do you work out the because the whole process does not explain anything to the user and how the user will be interacting with this poor guy sitting miles away and how the support agent would help the user.
Yeah. Yeah. Should I repeat the questions, by the way? No? That's fine. Yeah. That's a really good question because, so the first few explorations I showed with the massive screens, I had a bunch of onboarding in there. And then I realized that the agent's talking to you. So he'll just say, oh, I'm going to send you an invite. You'll see a button that says screen share. Click on it. Okay. Now you'll see that there's a border and there's a button. And so he basically explains everything. And actually, what happened, even the animation that you saw of the button opening and closing, we ended up removing it in the end because it wasn't matching what the agent was saying. Because the agent was like, there's a button and it has controls in it. But the animation came and went already. So it was actually getting confusing. So particularly for this, we let...
Better to give the control to the agent and let him do what he wished to do, over the phone, he could understand or inquire what the user wished to achieve.
Yeah, so that, so we call that like remote access. So that was one of the things we thought of in our initial sprint, the one that we had right at the beginning. And we decided early on that that's not something we want to do because it has a lot more privacy implications.
That's very true, but don't you think that since you're coming out with all the legal notifications, legal everything, you're aware and informing the user that this is going to happen, right? So you may not have any obligation in the future, even if the phone is hacked or
Yeah, you're right. I think we might have been legally covered, but a lot of the times people don't read properly. And it's also about building trust. So we'd rather launch with something that we know works, build that brand, and then maybe we'll see in the future if it's even worth it.
But I still think the way the user, the code agent is working out with the user is a bit confusing, isn't it?
I mean, we tested it, so.
I mean, still, you work on Pixel, but what about the other brands and phones and
Yeah, I think a lot of it comes down to agent training as well.
And it also depends on your expansion, right? Because I'm not sure you did the testing just in the States, or you went outside states and tested.
Yeah, this one was in the States.
Yeah, that's where the problem comes in, because that's what I believe that the people from Southeast Asia and North, they might not be able to.
Yeah, I think a lot of areas, I'm not even sure if they have screen share available yet.
Yeah.
So we started off with the region that we thought, there, I don't even know if there are Pixel phones in Pakistan. Maybe someone, I guess I brought one. But a lot of the market right now is the US.
The screen share actually, and there is another application. I had the privilege to work on it. But that's not exactly an agent to user collaboration. That's more of just a simple screen share.
Yeah, I think once you test with the agent, it completely changes the game. Because you have this voiceover that's guiding you through everything. So a lot of our focus was also agent training, which I didn't really mention here. There's a whole another team that we worked with. Okay, yeah, we can continue talking about that later. Okay, so I gave one example. There are many different methods of doing UX. So what does it mean to me? This is my definition, so take it for what it's worth. So I think UX is a way of solving problems through the lens of a user in order to deliver easy to use, beautiful products within technical and business constraints. Long-winded. So the way of solving problems is kind of the you know, there's strategic thinking parts to it. There's also what artifacts you're creating. The lens of the user is things like the research, the psychology principles. Easy and beautiful is the testing, the visuals. And then the technical and business constraints requires a lot of communication and leadership and understanding of things beyond just design. So let's bust two myths. First one, UX equals UI. So I know this is a very contentious topic. Most of the people in the room will probably think this is not true, but I still want to get that across. So we talked about the two buckets of things that UX person can do. You know, they're helping solve the solve the right problem and that problem correctly. When we say UI, it kind of belittles the work, so people get offended, because it kind of limits it to this, where you're creating mocks and you're creating specs. Yes, we do design UI. That is the outcome of a larger process, of a way of thinking. So when people say UI, it makes us usually feel like we need to be brought in at the end to just design the features that someone else has already thought about. And it doesn't take into account all the user needs that drive our work. To bring that home a little bit, technically there are no UX designers at Google. We get hired at a lot of different job descriptions. So there are dedicated researchers, qualitative, quantitative. I'm an interaction designer. I was the only person on my project as a designer, so I was also doing the visuals, the prototyping. But people who do brand and creative and art type of work are actually under the marketing and communications umbrella. And I'm not saying that that isn't really critical work. The point I just want to get across is there is a distinction between the work that happens in product development and the work that happens within brand and marketing. And I'm also not saying that you need to have all these specialized roles. People often wear multiple hats. But it's good to know that all these different roles exist so you know what your strengths are, what you want to market. And when you try to recruit people, you try to understand which of these is the one that you want. Because if you actually look at, I looked at Rosie.pk, just give me one sec. Let me just, you actually see a lot of graphic designers and UI designers. And it could be that the designers are actually doing a lot of the strategic work, but marketing it like this makes it seem like we're doing a lot more limited work. And even web design, like a lot of designers today need to know how to do apps, how to cater for different platforms, not just the web. So when you're hiring, you probably want to make sure that the person knows how to do beyond web as well. So it just makes it seem a little smaller than it is. Yes?
Okay. Yeah. Mm-hmm. What's the difference here between a UX writer and a UX engineer?
Okay, so UX writer is actually a person who writes, not code, the text on the page. So for example, there aren't that many of them, it's kind of a rare role at Google. But for example, that screen I showed that needed to have legal copy in it. I did my version of it, but then I had to take it to her and make sure that it was as crisp and catchy as it could be, yet also meeting all the legal requirements.
It's sort of content writing?
It is content writing, yeah.
And the engineer guy is basically?
The engineer guy is usually a prototyper, and we have two lenses for that. Usually one person is a lot more engineering heavy, and they write production ready code, and then a prototyper who does a lot more testing related stuff, but they're still called UX engineers. Yeah. A production designer is probably the closest to a UI designer. It's usually like someone a little more junior who we'll hire to help with that final step of the specking out the red lines to give to the engineer. No?
So can't they just rephrase the interaction designer as user experience designer? That would be much...
So UX is all of this.
I understand UX is all of it, but...
So I'm, for example, not a researcher.
Right.
So often when we do testing, sometimes I'll conduct the testing, but often I'm observing and taking notes. So the researcher is the one who's talking to the user. But all of them fall under UX. A UX designer could do all of these things, but my focus, for example, I'm not as good as at the visuals as I am at the interaction.
Not exactly, because recent study says that UX designers are not mandatory to have the knowledge even for a user interface or even a design actually, because UX are not equal to UIs at all. I mean, they are different, that's different.
So interaction does imply a little bit of digital knowledge, for example.
That's right. Knowledge is fine, but design is not necessary. They don't have to be have any idea about design, how good the design would be. It's just experience, or in your case, interaction, is what's more important.
I think the point's clear, so it's fine. Yeah. Okay. Well. Okay. Hopefully. Good. Next one. This one bothers me a little bit, so this is going to be a little longer than the last one. Hopefully, we'll get some principles out of it. So UX people are just artsy-fartsy. Okay. One, I think we've communicated, requires some engineering and technical business knowledge to actually get a project shipped. I can't just dream up of an idea. I need to know what the engineering cost is, what the business metrics would be associated with it. Two, we kind of walk through a little bit of the process. So you're essentially employing the scientific method. You're saying, here's my hypothesis. I think the solution will work. You go out and you test it. You find a solution, you refine it. Third, I'll talk about it's not art on like one slide. And then the fourth one is the one I'll go into a bit more. So art versus design. Art is also really important, but there are differences between art and design. So where art kind of makes you think about, you know, something provocative, it evokes emotion. UX is supposed to be a lot more clear. You kind of want UX design to just fade into the background and you don't really think about it. And it's a lot more action driven than art. Sorry, one second, I'm just going to move forward in my... and where art is a lot more about creative freedom, no one can say you did it right or wrong. But if you launch a design without testing, people will probably say it could be wrong. So there's a lot more process to it. Okay. So the other part that I want to focus on is psychology principles that UX people use. And this part really fascinates me, but I'll give four examples. I'm going to actually switch to a video that hopefully will play. So maybe some of you have seen it, but we'll see. Can you guys hear it? Should I pause it? You can kind of hear it, read it anyway, so it's not that big a deal.
The monkey business illusion. Count how many times the players wearing white pass the ball.
How many? 27. 16? Okay, 15, 16? Something like that? Okay.
The correct answer is 16 passes. Did you spot the gorilla?
Yeah.
For people who haven't seen or heard about a video like this before, about half missed the gorilla.
Okay, who missed the gorilla? Okay. Not that many.
If you knew about the gorilla, you probably saw it. But did you notice the curtain changing color for the player on the black team leaving the game? Let's rewind and watch it again. Here comes the gorilla, and there goes a player, and the curtain is changing from red to gold. Looking for a gorilla, you often miss other unexpected events.
Yeah. Yeah, so the gorilla experiment is somewhat famous. I had a feeling a lot of people might know it. But how many people didn't spot the other things, the other two things? Okay, good. So I was like, if all the people here are designers, they might have seen that too, but good. Okay. So we call that limited cognitive cycles. So basically, when you're focused on something, you don't notice the other things that are happening. So this was one of the reasons for the earlier example I gave of you having that button be persistent rather than the notification at the top. So you have like this little icon at the top. Maybe even if we pop the notification, chances are while the agent is guiding you, you're going to forget that there was this little thing up there or you won't notice it. So we want something, especially in this use case where you're frustrated and annoyed, that the controls for screen share be prominent. And we had a lot of debate because that button was a new pattern. But because of these kinds of things, this is why we were able to win that argument, because it was a lot more work. The next thing I'll talk about a little bit are what's called gestalt principles. Roughly, show of hands, people know, heard of this? Okay. So this is basically the idea that the brain works in a way that tries to bring order and groupings to things that you're seeing. So here, for example, it's just 5x5, there's no real grouping. By using a little bit of similarity, so in this case a darker color, I'm able to imply some relationship between some of them versus others. So in this case, you're likely to see them as rows over columns over rows. But if I add spaces between them, now you see three groups. And that three group thing is stronger than the color relationship. So knowing these kinds of things helps you get people to group things and scan pages in a certain way. So for example, on this screen that you've seen a few times now, like I know that these things are small, fine print, and this is an area with buttons. And it doesn't matter if the button's green or white and it looks like the same font as the things above. The buttons below and the things are at the top. So when a user looks at the page, they'll probably say, fine print, don't want to read it, button click. And it's a lot faster to comprehend a page like that. Does anyone know where I'm going with this one? Raise of hands. Okay. So Don Norman's book, Design of Everyday Things, a bunch of people might have read it. It talks a lot about faucets and doorknobs and how annoying they are, even though they're so common in the real world. So this one is a particularly annoying door because it has a bar, and bars you want to push. And this door wants to be pulled. So chances are you'll walk into the door and bang against it, and then you'll have to pull it. So what we call these kinds of characteristics, these visual characteristics of things, as affordances. They imply how you should use them. So the first door, you know that the bar is on the left. It's probably going to pivot this way. You have to push on that side. And it's particularly important because that's for exit doors. You don't want to get confused at that time. Door handles, they have a little groove, you can pull on them, you know that that's what they're for. Sliders, it has a little groove, you pull it like that. So these kinds of things, this is like a simple example. So for the button, I needed enough depth and shadow so that I could say, this is not like any other button. It's going to float above all the other UI. So if you scroll on this page, this button's not going to move with it. It still has depth, so it's a button, you can click on it. And for some reasons, this didn't test perfectly, but some people were able to drag it and other people didn't think about it, but it does move. And one of the things I want to emphasize here is that these things are important because affordances usually happen across different screens and across different products. And a lot of the mistake that people sometimes make is they want things to look unique. And you come up with this really like interesting shaped button or something, and then people don't know how to use it. So you don't have to do that. Your first thing should be getting people to actually understand. So consistency is important, and inconsistency comes at a cost.
Yeah? What does grouping have with the door with affordances? Like what's the relation between them?
With what, sorry?
The relation between grouping and affordances.
So the grouping thing, so this is the third one, sorry. So I finished that one here. So the gestalt principles were the second one. So I moved on to the third one. Sorry, my bad. Yeah, so the third sort of principle that I'm talking about is affordances. Yeah? Any other thoughts? Okay, last one. Another principle called hindsight bias. So I worked with our icons team to come up with a good icon for screen share. You know, we already have an icon for desktop screen share. We already have an icon for share. Let's take the mobile icon, put a share in it, and screen share. Like, what else could it possibly be? When we tested this, one of the guys was like, oh, it looks like an exit sign. And I didn't think of that. It was only one person, and it actually worked in our favor because he thought he could exit screen share through that button, which you actually can do. But for example, he didn't understand that there could be other controls behind it. We ended up not acting on this finding, but it's good to know that whenever you build something, you bring with it all the knowledge that it took to come up to that solution. But when people see it for the first time, they don't see it. This also happens, like if I ask you to think of a song in your head, just do it quickly, any song. Okay. Now, if you tap, like try to tap it and try to get someone to figure out what song it is, they won't know. And in your mind, you're like, no, I'm tapping the melody. But because you know the song, it's a lot easier to think that you're making sense. So always test. This is one of the principles that tells us, you know, make sure you're testing what you're doing. So next time you see like Taylor Swift say, you know, I knew you were trouble when you walked in. It's like, no, actually you only knew it later once you met him and, you know, went out with him. So, okay. So there are a bunch more of these and I wanted to go into more, but it could take forever. There are a few books here and I'll probably share out the slides and stuff. Goodreads. Okay. That's good. Okay, so this is the last thing, and we're doing okay on time. So how do you build a culture for UX? Now, we've kind of established, okay, it's not fluffy stuff, it's not artsy-fartsy, it does require some brains, but you still don't think it's important enough to do. And oftentimes, what people will equate it with is something like this. So, you know, Google came out with this voice command for turning on and off your flashlight when the Fantastic Beasts movie came out. It's, you know, essentially a magical, delightful experience where you didn't know you could do something and now you can do it and, oh, maybe the designer did it or they understand their users really well. And this is there, but what I want to get you to think is more UX for this. This has to be done early on, so you can't do those delightful moments if you don't understand the basic needs of your user. So if you're building the best possible film camera feature, it's still not meeting the mark because you're not solving for the right problem. So again, going back to the beginning, involving UX from the beginning. The way I like to kind of think of it is, you might have seen Maslow's hierarchy of needs, you know, how a person progresses, self-actualizes. So that kind of thing also applies to products. They're basic needs of the users that they're trying to accomplish, and you need to meet those expectations. And sometimes people are like, oh, this is not innovative enough, and it's not. But doing that basic thing, that those critical journeys really well, is actually what makes the people come back again and again. And then sometimes you'll do like those rare moments of delight that help with the brand, essentially. So this is where UX comes in. You should involve them early on. Let's talk about two things, two arguments that tend to happen. We don't have enough time. So let's talk about the left side first. What I want to argue is that UX will help save time. You're solving the right problem. So instead of trying to backtrack if you're Kodak and now try to build digital camera when everyone's moved ahead, you're solving the right problem from the beginning. Things like this design sprints help you align your team a lot early on. So you're not having arguments later on what to build. You're all focused and you're marching towards the same goal. Failure is early. So when you're doing research, when you're doing testing, you know that your product's basically going to work before you launch it. And you're not trying to backstep at the last moment. But no one has all the time in the world. Every company has to face this problem. So you have to become efficient. finding out how to standardize your process? Is there something that engineers can do while you're doing rough mocks? Maybe they can start building the back end, and then as the process moves forward, they can start refining something. So trying to work in a more agile way. Obviously, the faster you are with your tools, the hotkeys, whatever tutorials you have, being able to have that speed when I'm doing explorations really helps me get my thoughts out fast. There are a lot of lo-fi methods, so you know, you can do click-through prototypes. You don't have to code everything up. So really making sure you're using your time effectively for the kind of data that you need. Never compromise on user journeys. So that's not a step that you should remove. You should still try to know what the user needs and walk through that end to end. And the last one is, like, constraints can be great. So I was having a one-on-one with my manager recently where I was like, I didn't do laundry this morning, and I realized that these other jeans go really well with my other outfit. And the only way I realized that was because it got me out of my rut, because my regular jeans were not there. So you kind of start thinking out of the box a lot more when you're actually constrained. It's a little ironic. Yep. So I would say we did one sort of foundational research in the beginning that I showed with the Larry phone.
I assume it's quite detailed exploration, or we can say that it's a quick and dirty kind of a thing.
I would say this one, for this project, it was somewhere in the middle. Ideally, I would have actually brought a lot more people to our campus and done it, but we ended up shadowing a lot of agents and looking at use cases that way. We also had a lot of engineers and product managers shadow sessions, so it wasn't just me. So we kind of divided and conquered. That way everyone had a bit of an understanding. So it was, I wouldn't say it was really high, you know, everyone's taking notes or something. It was a lot more about empathy building at that point, so that everyone gets a sense of the problem, so that we start the project off on the right footing. The later two that we did, I would say, were a lot more methodical. We had a proper researcher, you know, she's trained in how to do unbiased questions. We recorded everything, shared those recordings. One was a lo-fi prototype that I made. Probably takes me about a week, maybe. Usually the problem is creating the right scenario. So when someone's walking through the prototype, they can get into the right mindset. It's not actually the coding of it. And then the other one was an engineering prototype. Yeah. Okay, the other one, I don't have the money for this. So usually time equals money, so a lot of the things that I just said apply here. But just to dig into that a little deeper, UX can help you create the right, you know, sign-up flows, right payment flows. You actually get people through and converting. And once they do convert, they tend to stay longer because they like your product. They come back again and again. All those things add up to sales. And on the cost side, like I mentioned, you're saving on all the failure that you would have had later down the road. All the mocks that you're building are saving on engineering time. The engineer is not spending all that time coding and changing. So all those things add up to money as well. I linked a great paper here that actually has a lot more in-depth case studies. So if you are talking to a business person and they want numbers, that's a good one to say, like, it has examples of like how Virgin Mobile did a responsive redesign and it increased their conversion rates. And so if you want actual numbers, that's a good document to look at. Money-wise, same sort of things we were talking about. I've also done cafe studies. So literally, like, I'll take some of these Android figurines that Jehan loves and then sit in a cafe and bribe people to essentially sit with me for 15 minutes and walk through something. And often they'll be Googlers or guests of Googlers. So you're not getting necessarily the final users, but it's a good proxy and it's fast. Gives us a good sanity check and it's low cost. Same thing with the kinds of tools that we're using. You don't always have to use the most complex JavaScript prototyping tools. Like, you could just use a simple click-through ones a lot of the way. And a quick note on recruiting UX talent. I personally think a lot of ownership and strategic involvement for a UX person can go a long way in recruiting them. You're more willing to take a little bit of a pay cut if you feel like the job is meaningful and people respect you than to get hired and be essentially a graphics monkey or something. So just a note on that. Okay, so last few slides. So if you're building UX culture, one of the big things, like I think it's a theme here, is understand the other role. So using the arguments that we've had so far, the business person should be able to say, hey, the UX person's valuable. I think for my goal, I need to make money, and I think the UX person can help me get there by avoiding those failures and increasing sales. Same thing with the engineer. You should look to your UX person and say, this is someone who can save me a lot of headache down the road. It will make sure that the business guy knows exactly what he wants. I have the piece of paper. Like, if he wanted something changed, he should have said that a while ago. Like, you're all a lot more on the same page. So understand the value that the other person can bring for you. And same thing for the designers. You should realize you're not the only person. You need the engineers and business people to actually launch to market. And it's good to have all that coding knowledge if you have it, but at least overall you should have a sense of this is costly, this is not. At least that much familiarity with what the other people are doing and speak their language so that all those reviews and communications go well. Okay, so the last thing I'll end with is I use Uber a lot in the US. And just now for the first time I took Uber coming here, or Kareem coming here. And a lot of my female friends have said they prefer Kareem over Uber. You know, the drivers feel safer. It's a lot easier to tell what the car actually is. It's more accurate. And I'm not going to get into a debate of which is better. But the mere fact that Kareem is able to be competitive against something like Uber is a testament to the fact that they understand their users well. You can't just take an idea from another place and embed it into a different place and expect it to work. That mapping requires understanding of the user and the context. And that's why designers in Pakistan are really important, because you have a better sense of your market and you can do research in your local areas and help make sure that the products that we develop here have good user experience. The end. Questions?
Yeah, so my question is around, so I'm an e-commerce co-founder in Pakistan, and we don't have a UX engineer. So it's very interesting. Okay, we ask a designer to do some of it, to do some. How do we start an effective UX function within the company? And I think for many startups, that might be a challenge.
Yeah. One, I would try to talk to the people who have done it successfully. So I'll admit my humility there. How many people do you have in your company?
So we have about 50 people.
So if you have 50, I feel like you should be able to spare one designer.
No. So it's not about
It's
cost.
A talent thing.
It's not about cost. It's about, I'm not a designer. Okay, so I'm from a technology background. Although I understand bits and pieces of it, but I'm very nervous hiring the first UX person. That's my challenge. It's not, probably not about cost. I understand it will increase conversion. It will pay for itself. So I understand that.
Okay.
I can spare a desk. I can spare a PC. I can spare some money on the tools. It's more about how do we start the UX function? How do we get design thinking into the organization? That's my
challenge. Yeah. I think there are a bunch of good designers in Pakistan. A bunch of them have gotten proper training abroad as well. So I think the number of people who know this is increasing. I also think for you, knowing these kinds of things, of what it is that you want out of a designer, will help you vet and make sure that the first person you do hire is doing the kind of thinking that you need. And you'll never know until you hire someone, I guess. Yeah, and I think the best would be like, going to the universities or the schools and stuff, or advertising, and like there's a Facebook group that has UX designers on it.
Yeah, I'm part of it.
Yeah, so those kinds of networks, and then just recruiting and interviewing properly. But then I think you've passed the first hurdle, though, is realizing that it's important. So give yourself credit for that. And then realizing how to interview the right people. Yeah.
My question is regarding the user group or which you are building a software. Like, we didn't build software for the internet. The customers or the users are in the same house. So we don't see any value in implementing all these UI principles for building a good UI, because they say that we can make people or anything.
Yeah. So that my larger team, so I work in our sales, marketing, and support team. I'm the only person on my team that works on user-facing stuff. Everyone else on my team works on internal Google tools. So we've faced that problem as well. I think a lot of the times it requires good leadership to say, no, this has to be quality stuff, because you still need to increase productivity, and productivity will improve sales. There are a lot of issues sometimes with trainings as well. You know, people don't attend training, they sleep through training, something or the other goes wrong. So as intuitive as the product can be, that will make the tools more efficient, it'll increase internal productivity. But I would say it needs someone at the top usually for those kinds of things to push it through. Yeah, I don't know.
Give them the new UI test or the new fancy stuff over the internet. They are not interested on working on that because they use keyboard, keyboard and mouse.
But that's a good thing. So you can develop things. So you have to make sure that you're building for them and not consumers. So I'm not saying that it should look like an app with one button on it. The tools that those people need are usually a lot more dense. And have a lot more like keyboard shortcuts and things like that. So it's not going to be as simple looking as a consumer facing product, but it should feel intuitive to the person who needs to use it. So if I'm using Gmail every day, I don't need to have like a lot of space and stuff. I know that it is complex in certain ways. And the tool should then feel a little complex. It should still let me do what I want to do. I feel a little complex is the wrong word, but it would be different from a consumer-facing product, as long as you test with those users who are going to use it day in and day out. Yeah.
Any sort of convincing the business guy to accept your idea?
Data.
Specifically when it comes to finance assets. Any tips how you manage to push your ideas forward?
So a lot of the time, the testing really helps. They're usually very data-driven people. So the more I can talk in numbers and metrics, the more it helps. That's why it helps me to also look at past projects and see what was the customer satisfaction for it. It's not working. Maybe let's set a goal that we'll improve this metric by doing this project. Yeah, and then honestly, good relationships go a long way. So I think one of the reasons why I feel somewhat successful in my job is that I try to get to know the people at work. I try to have one-on-ones with them. That way they know that, you know, I'm not just using them, I'm interested in them, I respect them, and then they reciprocate. They tend to listen to you. The harder problem is usually getting them to just respect you and listen to you and take you seriously. Once you cross that barrier, they're like, oh, she probably means well, let's listen to what she wants to say. Yeah. Yeah. The end? Well, I think I'm around if anyone wants to talk, if people want to mingle or something. Can I take a selfie with everybody?
Yeah.
I feel like that's a trend,
right?
I was
waiting for you to say that.
Okay.
Okay,
I have one question.
Oh.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. It just came to my mind.
Yeah, go for it.
While
The UX, what impact does the UX, Google is also mapping the user experience in the ranking of the website in SEO, for SEO. So how does this UX relate to in that area?
Yeah. Search is a giant team at Google, and I actually know some of the people who work on that. You never realize the kind of experiments that they're doing, and you might not notice them, but they're happening. And there's a lot more, I would say, visual kind of work that also drives that. So every pixel on that search results page is accounted for. You have to that argument of being able to advocate for the user in front of a business person is very strong in that particular group, because any small thing you want to change could have billions of dollars of revenue impact. So if you want to change the font because it feels more on brand and friendly, that's a very user-centric thing to say. How do you get the business person to agree? So that's kind of where the UX person comes in and makes those arguments. Yeah. And they do a lot of work with the commerce team too, like shopping and flights and things like that.
Yeah, I developed BI applications for the decision makers of different market areas. So whenever I develop it first time on the interface, they always ask to change some things in it. So what is the best way to get the requirements correctly first time?
So are you a front-end developer?
No, I'm not a front-end developer. I'm just a BI application. I use a tool.
Okay. Would you so you're designing it and developing it?
Yes.
Okay. I think the first thing would be to just do sketches. Just generally agree on these are the goals that we're trying to meet and this is how we're going to do it before you go into something that is going to take up more of your time. Yeah, so the more of the low fidelity work you can do early on and get agreement on, then the kind of things they'll comment on are like, move this a few pixels as opposed to change this whole page.
I don't want to see this in this way, I want to see in that way. This is their way.
Like visual tweaks. Yeah, that is something we have to work on together, I think, as a culture. Respect for a designer and saying, this person does their job. You know, and once you test with it, I guess that's the only other way to get people to agree. Either you build your own credibility and they trust your intuition, or you bring in data from somewhere, like testing it somehow. Yeah, and it can help to have someone senior vouch for you. So if they don't think you're credible enough, getting your manager or their manager to agree that what you're saying is right can also go along. So that's why I'm saying a lot of it is communication for designers, navigating people. Mm-hmm. What is the difference in your mind?
Customer experience is kind of marketing, I think so.
Both are important. I feel like when you think of marketing, it's just usually someone else does it. I don't actually do it, but you have to do both. If you don't build a good product, people who do get the marketing and get into those funnels are not going to use it. So you kind of need both. As a UX designer, I think user experience, because that's my job. Yeah. For a UX designer, it's usually the user experience. So if you can find a marketing person, right? Otherwise, someone else needs to deal with the marketing. Maybe the business person needs to deal with it. Yeah. Kiawa?
No, I'm trying to fill these front chairs so that our selfie comes out better. Everybody's being shy. Right?
Yes. You want to go for it?
No, you're going to take it. I'm not a selfie expert with my round face, all right?
Okay. Smile, wave.
Come on, wave!
Okay.
All right. Now with your phone?
Oh, it's fine. I'll take it from you.
Oh, okay. All right. So thanks a lot, Saba.
Yeah. my pleasure.
Yeah.
ये सारी चीजें फॉर्म्स पे भी अप्लाई होती हैं, पर जस्ट द पैटर्न्स माइट लुक अ लिटिल डिफरेंट. तो वी टेस्टिंग है, वी रिसर्च है. फॉर्म्स का फॉर एग्जांपल द बिजनेस गाय इज गोना से हमें ये सारी फील्ड्स चाहिए, एंड देन द यूएक्स पर्सन सेज नो एक्चुअली नहीं चाहिए, यू शुड रियली थिंक अबाउट इट बिकॉज यू हैव टू ट्रेड ऑफ बिटवीन लोग पूरा फॉर्म भरेंगे एंड एक्चुअली सबमिट इट एंड यू गेट ऑल दिस डेटा, या फिर लोग आएंगे ही नहीं, फिल ही नहीं करेंगे. सो डू यू वांट क्वांटिटी और लाइक क्वालिटी ऑफ डेटा, एंड देन यू मेक अ ट्रेड ऑफ, ओके ये वाली फील्ड हटा देते हैं, ये वाली फील्ड हटा देते हैं.
क्योंकि अब इतना बड़ा फॉर्म है, वो मैं भी अगर खुद जाऊं तो मैं फिल करने में घबराऊंगा, इतना बड़ा, इतना टाइम मेरे पास है नहीं एक्चुअली.
I have
within seconds आप क्लिक करते हो कि मुझे ये फिल करना है या मैं छोड़ के जाना.
एंड द प्रॉब्लम मोबाइल पे और भी ज्यादा प्रॉब्लम एग्रीवेट हो जाती है, यू नीड बिग बटन्स एंड स्मॉल स्क्रीन्स. तो yeah, so a lot of this is you fighting for the user and the business guy fighting for their business, and then you have to have enough mutual respect and discussion to come to a consensus somewhere in the middle. Yeah,
there's one there
behind you.
Yeah, behind you. You sort of used up more than your quota of questions.
Just want to make one point. I'm not a designer, I'm not a coder or a developer engineer. I come from the business side, and I have a lot of experience, 18 years of experience to be specific. A lot of questions here were how to convince the client. What I see over my career and even here, people are talking that the objectives need to be very well defined. You need to probe the business person, the client, about specific objectives they want to achieve from that specific page or that task or anything.
Yeah.
That's what I designers mere paas aate hain, they try to push the design ka creative idea hai, okay these are my objectives.
Yep.
Are they being met?
Yeah.
If they are being met, then it's okay with me. They are, but 80% of the time they are not being met. So I think that is
change your designer. If 80% of the time your objectives are not being met, you probably haven't hired the right designer.
So a lot of what I try to argue for is a good designer doesn't just come up with creative solutions in isolation. They have to do business and engineering needs together. So there's this idea that mere team ke saath bhi hota hai, Google mein bhi hota hai. Oh, we have to do something innovative. Da, 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 da. Innovative cheez dikhao. Oh, this is going to take 2 years to build. Okay, then in 1 month you can only build this. So let's build it. So we hit our target.
So I just wanted to add up to cheez mein ke for forms you can do A/B testing and data ke sath you can speak a lot ke ji idhar agar is form ko itne log drop out ho rahe hain, bounce rate aapka bad hai, to that is 100 times more than aap usko convince karne. To chhota sa A/B test run kare, ek form dusra form, 50 user is pe 50 is pe.
Yeah. The other, there's this guy, Luke W. ke naam se, he has a blog, Luke Wobowski, or I always forget his last name. He's written like books on forms. So if you're doing a lot of forms, that would be the guy I would say, go read. Yeah.
You want to give him another chance to ask a question?
Kisi aur ke paas question hai? Okay, sure, go for it.
I just wanted to help people out here. एजुकेशन का प्रोसेस हो जाएगा तो वो चीजें काफी अंडरस्टैंडेबल हो जाती है और डिजाइनर को इतना प्रॉब्लम भी नहीं होता वो समझाने में.
अगर ये उसको पता है जो प्रोडक्ट ओनर है उसको पता है कि जितना भी मैं ये काम कर रहा हूँ अगर डिज़ाइनर डिज़ाइन बनाने की बजाय वो पहले उसको समझाएं डिज़ाइन इससे ये चीज़ें अचीव हो जाएंगी तो आई थिंक वो ज़्यादा बेटर हो जाएगा.
देखिए एक चीज फ्रॉम माय पर्सपेक्टिव आई रैन अ कंपनी एंड वी आई यूज्ड टू डील विद क्लाइंट्स एंड माय डिजाइनर्स वुड मेक थिंग्स दैट दे वुड वांट टू चेंज. बेसिक चीजें ये आपने लाल बनाया इसको हरा नहीं कर सकते मतलब इस तरह की स्टूपिड
सी लाइकिंग्स
नहीं नहीं बट देन यू हैव टू पुट योर फुट डाउन एट सम स्टेज एंड आई यूज्ड टू से आई डोंट इंटरफेयर विद माय डिजाइनर्स दे आर द प्रोफेशनल्स एंड एक्सपर्ट्स इन दिस एरिया इवन आई डोंट टेल देम व्हाट टू डू. तो आप बताएं कि आप हरा रंग किस लिए इस्तेमाल करना चाहते हैं.
यू नो देयर इज एंड आई एम सॉरी कटिंग यू ऑफ बट देयर वाज वन फैक्टर इन वन स्मॉल थिंग व्हिच इज फॉर लाइकिंग एंड आई हैव स्पोकन टू मेनी पीपल आउट देयर एक्सपर्ट्स बिलोंग्स टू डिफरेंट इंस्टीट्यूशंस बिलोंग्स टू डिफरेंट कल्चर व्हाट दे केम अप विद द लाइकिंग हैज नो अल्टरनेटिव. इफ द गाय डज नॉट लाइक दैट पर्टिकुलर लोगो even you give him millions of designs he will not be able to like them. He just his liking has developed in a different way. So
then how do you educate them?
You cannot educate them and there isn't any solution I have found yet.
So these problems are a little more on the visual design side.
Yeah.
And often the visual designers are on the edge of what the brand the visuals are today. So
it kind of a shortcut would be add interactivity and I found especially in the forms case I was building something similar and I came across with an example and it was really nice. Actually people were involved into the fill up the form. They were filling up again and again and again and again. Why? Because they just loved it the way it's presented. We just added some animation to it and it was slicing animation to a form actually. Then when you're crossing it, it just gone and there's again. So people were loving, oh that's nice, let's fill it again. That's nice, let's fill it again. So
I wouldn't have.
One thing.
Okay. Yeah. No, now your time is out.
One thing I'll add to the general argument of how do you convince a client or a business person. So the sprints that I mentioned, for example, a lot of the people on my team had never done a sprint before. So you can't always wait for someone to give you credibility. You have to sort of show something, and then they're like, "Oh, this person's actually intelligent. They do something," and then they bring you to the next meeting, and then they start getting you involved. So you have to fight for that seat at the table rather than wait for someone to invite you.
All right. So thank you, Saba. You had a lot of helpers who were also wanting to sort of give their advice, which is great. There's a lot of interaction.
That's good.
Yeah. Thanks so much.
Yes.
And we'll have you back.
Inshallah.
Time you're here.
Inshallah.
All right. Thank you.
Oh.
This is a little memento from the
Thank you.